Okay, well, welcome back to Liquid Audio in Perth, Western Australia. Liquid Audio, cherishing classic audio. And here, of course, we have the famous, the massive, the gigantic, and the tremendous Yamaha GT-2000 turntable. And just to prove that it really is gigantic and tremendous, you can see it right there. Possibly the most ridiculous product line designation ever thought of. And of course, it had to be my beloved Yamaha that came up with it. I mean, I love Yamaha, but really gigantic and tremendous. Guys, what were you thinking / smoking / drinking? I don't know. Anyway, this belongs to a good buddy. Actually, I was just interrupted then by the owner who rang me, and we were just chatting about what I'm actually doing to this. So once again, look, apologies for the work area. I'm out of space here at Liquid Audio. I have so much hi-fi gear here from owners in Perth that I've literally run out of room, and I've only just created my new storage facility. But anyway, that's another matter. What we're doing on this one, because this friend of mine has put a new hi-fi rack and setup together, he's got a new specialized granite table for this deck, and it's resting on that table. And so basically, it is too far from his Krell preamp. And so what I need to do is extend this cable. And so rather than just extend the cable, which is a fairly, it's not a great cable, it's okay, but rather than just extend that, we're just gonna put a new cable in. I'll make a new custom Megami cable up for this deck and we will put it in. All right, so we're back here with the Yamaha GT-2000. And the GT-2000 needed a new lead out cable or tone arm cable. So I had to custom make one, and that's what I've done. I have now just put it back together. So a quick tour of this cable. I've used Megami Neglex. I use different kinds of Megami cable for different purposes, but anyway, I've used a particular Neglex that I like in this capacity. I've used a couple of high quality Amphenol connectors. These are the better ones. They're probably my favorite ones. There's another series which I like as well, but these ones work quite well. I do like them. And I've got some nice silicone copper cable for the ground connection. And so, look, getting all this terminated, getting these two wires terminated, treated, kind of cut, and ready for reinsertion into this and to mate the tone arm cables up to was no mean feat. It was actually significantly tedious, I'm going to be honest and say. I hope you can see it here. I haven't soldered to these yet. I'm about to do that. That's the next part. And of course, getting this clamp back in place. I've lubricated the screws. Of course, that's how you know that I work. No one else would do that, but I have done that. And it made a big difference in just how easily I was able to get this clamp back in place onto this lovely Megami Japanese cable. So anyhow, that's the next job. The next job is just to solder to these terminated cables, and fingers crossed, everything will be fine. And of course, I've just got to also solder on the earth wire, the ground wire, to this little tab here. I've gotten that ready with some heat shrink ready to go. And yeah, we'll get going on that. And then probably the next little piece I do will be when this job is done. Oh my God, I'll be pleased when it's finished. Stand by. Okay, just a very quick follow-up. So it's difficult to see. Oh, you can probably see okay in there. So they're all reconnected. I'm now going to test everything and make sure everything is good. I've got my ground as well. And I haven't heat shrunk that. Yeah, it's a little bit hard to heat shrink the tubing without kind of affecting everything around it. I'm going to have to be a bit careful there. I might try it. But anyway, those are reconnected. So we're going to do a quick sound check now and see if everything is working. Right, welcome back. Well, we have the cable finished. I have shrunk all of my bundles. I've bundled everything back up. Heat shrunk the ground. Heat shrunk all of these. Well, just the nice little touches like heat shrinking the bundle where it goes under the cable clamp. And then I've done multiple of that. I don't know if you can see that. Hopefully you can. Multiple little heat shrinking, put on a new ground spade, and you know, all the things. Again, sorry for the messy desk. I'm so sorry, guys. I am so under the pump at the moment. Show you the turntable. And there it is. Beautiful. Now I've just tested it and it is beautiful. I've just set the tracking force again. And there it is playing a record. And let's see if we can just so that for all of you GT-2000 lovers out there who want to actually hear it, you can only hear it through headphones, but you'll be able to hear it. Let me...
The bandits had escaped. The hunters did not know what had happened to Diana's parents. They asked her where she
came from. Great record. I highly recommend it.
She was only a baby and she couldn't tell them. Not knowing what else to do,
they took the little girl. There she is. Okay, here we are back for the very last part of this video about the Yamaha GT-2000. So, hopefully you've watched this far. You know that I've replaced the cable with a premium Megami Neglex audio cable. And I can, of course, fit these to your deck if you so wish. The other thing I've done in this case, I've serviced the deck, cleaned it, lubricated the hinges, adjusted the tracking force, anti-skate, etc., etc. Fitted new bump stops for the lid. I like doing this. This is a big thing that I try to do on decks where they don't have them, because rather than the lid clattering down on the top of the deck, it now shuts beautifully, and there's a nice tight shut line, which you'll see, which is dead even all the way across, and in fact all the way down the side to the back. So I obviously choose these bump stops to suit the deck and to suit the height of that, the gap that I'm trying to achieve is what I'm trying to say here. My brain is fried, it's been one of those days. So yes, the GT-2000, now it is gigantic and it is tremendous, hence the GT designation. And what do I think of this deck? Well, look, they're popular now. They've become really much more popular in the last few years. I've heard this deck quite a bit. It sounds good. It is mechanically very robust, very solid. It's about 30 kilos of just wood and aluminium, and sort of brass and different alloys. It's got a nice long arm, which is great for reducing tracking error and therefore tracking distortion. But if I'm honest, the arm is not the greatest arm. You know, it is okay. The height adjustment is somewhat crude. It really likes light cartridges and therefore fairly compliant cartridges. We do get a bit stuck with certain combinations of cartridges and head shells, but that's fairly normal. The deck itself is very simple to operate. Speed selector on the left, start stop on the right. And when I say start stop, this is just platter start and stop. There's no automated functions here. I think the only thing that my friend who owns this deck has fitted is an automatic arm lifter at the end for when he's had a couple of glasses of wine too many and sort of maybe dozes off so he doesn't wear out his stylus. But, you know, other than that, these decks are pretty basic. Now, basic is good in a turntable. In fact, the less it does, the better we generally like them, because the less stuff you have hanging off this tone arm in terms of mechanisms and various other things, the less there is to go wrong, number one. And the less there is to take away from the acoustic properties, if you like, of the arm and its ability to dig detail out of the groove, which is what we're trying to do. We're trying to extract detail from the groove, and anything that sort of saps acoustic energy from this arm tube or adds its own sources of energy, vibrational energy, energy from the motor back through into the arm, things like that. Anything like that we don't want. So in fact, we want the arm to be nice and inert. We want it to be bolted rigidly to the chassis, and we want that all to be decoupled from the motor where possible, and we want nothing else hanging off that arm. So yeah, from that point of view, they're quite good. I'm not sure why I went off on this arm tangent, but anyway, I'm just thinking about the deck and what I think of it. Is it a super deck? Yeah, possibly. It is one of the great direct drive turntables from Japan, and therefore one of the great turntables from Japan. There's no question about that. It's a very, very good deck. I think with the right cartridge, we fitted a Fidelity Research FR2 to this with an RS10 head shell, which is a very nice combination. I think with that kind of combination, with the thing carefully set up and serviced, it has the potential to sound very, very good. And potentially it is a super deck, yeah. I mean, look, I've got an LO7D, which I slightly prefer. I think it's better made again. and I think it sounds better again. And I've got a Luxman PD350, which is a belt drive super deck from Japan, possibly one of the very best belt drives ever made. So both of those are considered super decks. I would say the GT2000 could be considered in that category, maybe not quite as good as those, but still, I mean, if you said, how does this compare to, say, Lin Sondek LP12 or a Riga RP6 or, you know, insert your sort of standard belt drive or Kenwood KD650 or a Kenwood KD550. So how does this compare to sort of good belt drive and direct drive other decks? Well, it's much better, of course. Something like this, it weighs 30 kilograms. I mean, the platter itself is about 8 or 10 kilos. I can't remember, but it's a lot. So yes, it's definitely better. The only issue for me is this arm. The fact that you can't change this arm, because I know, for example, that, you know, on a KD, you know, on a KD, say 600, you could change the arm, put on a different arm, you know, on my Luxman PD350, you can change the arm, put on a different arm. So, but with this one, you are almost stuck with this arm. There's not a lot of other stuff you can fit to it. So, you know, but hey, every deck has its compromises. And this one, of course, is no different. It's a great deck. At least now it reaches the preamp, the Krell KRC HR, can be fed directly without any kludgy cable adapters or anything like that. It can now be directly fed from this beautiful, nice new cable. So that's a great result. I'm rambling. I'm going to stop now. If you've watched this far, I really appreciate it. Thanks a lot for watching, guys. And if there's anything that I can do to help you with your turntable, or if you'd like me to look at yours, if you live local to Perth, if you'd like me to fit a new cable, or anything else like that you need only, get in touch with me, Mike, at liquidaudio@iinet.net.au. Or visit my website, liquidaudio.com.au. Thanks for watching.